And I'm happy to have Summer Smith presenting again this evening. Summer is, she works with Wise County GIS. She's also an Extension Leadership Council member, works very closely with the Emergency Operations Center here in Wise County. And she spoke with you all about drones. And tonight she's going to be talking about weather preparedness. So I'm going to turn it over to her. And Summer, take it away.
How is everybody tonight? Everybody looks muted, so I'll just take your word for it. I hope everybody's okay. So tonight, pardon me, get me a drink.
COVID.
I hope not. Don't say that. So tonight I'm going to talk to you a little bit about weather. We deal with all kinds of weather, much more so recently than we have ever in my lifetime, especially as Jeremy and I were talking earlier, in the last 3 years, the rain is ridiculous. So anyway, I work for Wise County. I'm going to tell you a little bit about myself. I work for the Wise County GIS office. I'm the GIS technician. I'm at the county and I manage the 911 database. I also am the assistant to the EOC coordinator here in Wise County. So if there's an emergency, I'm with her. So I kind of do all kinds of things. Plus I'm a local beef cattle farm owner and I attend that. So I guess I'm a glutton for punishment sometimes for activities. But anyway, without further ado, I'll move on. And he did show me how to share this screen. So I'm going to go down here and see if I can figure out how to work this. Can everybody see that? I hope. I really feel I'm looking.
Yes.
I'm looking for, I can't see it because of the other controls up above my slideshow. I want to turn it into the slideshow. And I don't think there's any way to move that.
Okay.
And I don't want to mess it up. Let's see if I can make it like, let me do it this way. There we go. I got it. I had to play just for a minute. Sorry, guys. So there's a lot of slides in here. I have 30 some slides. I had done a weather preparedness last year for him and concentrated basically on the kinds of weather that we have here in Southwest Virginia. And this year he asked me to extend it. I also do a CERT program for the county. So I dabbled just a bit into that to get some more information. And they're lengthy, so I'm not going to read to you, but we'll cover them. So our philosophy here in Wise County is to always be prepared. You know, and part of my CERT training was, what do you do when there's a pandemic? And of course, everybody said that's never going to happen. And then we had to pull part of that packet out and figure out what to do 6 months ago. So never say never. You should always be prepared for the unexpected, as out there as that may be. So my top six thoughts right off the top of my head are, why do we prepare? Well, if your electricity goes out and you don't have any batteries for your flashlight and you don't have any candles, you're sitting in the dark. Or what's more, if it's wintertime and you don't have any heat, you're cold. And if you have children or elderly, that's really, really bad. So we always prepare. So our first intent to prepare is to keep ourselves and our loved ones safe. So that's why we prepare. So where do we get started? Well, we have to have a plan. Well, how do you get a plan? Well, Wise County has lots of materials and I have lots of links in here and I hope Phil shares this with everyone so that you may have them as well. We keep brochures and I wanted to bring them. I thought I had some, but I don't. We keep them in our GIS office. And it's just a basic little pamphlet, you know, maybe index card size. And it'll just give you a highlight of what does it mean to create a plan. You know, you got to think about all of your people involved and you and their need, each individual need. And obviously you want food and water and shelter. But then obviously it extends further than that. If you have children in the home, what are their needs? If you have elderly in the home, what are their needs? If you have pets, if you have a farm, if you have whatever your circumstances are. So you got to sit down, and it's not just something you can sit down and do in an hour. You kind of need to give it some thought. What do you use every day? When you get up in the morning until you go to bed at night, what do you need? Okay, then once you come up with that plan, then you start preparing for that plan, and you have so many days of water and so many days of food and so many days of backup heat. And if the electricity goes out and it's in the summertime, how are you going to keep your milk cold and that kind of thing? But the biggest thing is stay calm, because overreacting, you will lose your sense of awareness. So if you create a plan and you think it through and you have that kit, then you're prepared. So there's no reason to panic. Just take a big deep breath and follow your plan. And you need to rehearse your plan. That's key. Just like the kids that do the tornado drills. So I've already went over the why we prepare a little bit. So maybe that I'm getting ahead of myself, but maybe that'll make these 30 some slides go a little quicker. And I'm sorry it's so long, but you just can't cover eight or so different kinds of weather short and sweet usually. Okay, so what is an emergency? Well, an emergency is the unexpected. So, you know, somebody falls and breaks a leg, that's an emergency. It's when you have to make haste and you have to take swift action to do something. Well, lots of times, and nobody's going to know everything, because not that's impossible. So that's why we need to educate ourselves on what kinds of disasters, what kinds of emergencies are out there that we are prone to, and prepare for those. So here, these are just some thoughts generally that if I'm doing an in-person class, you know, I try to get people involved and I try to get them to think about what kind of emergency can you expect to have in your environment, and what would you do about it? Where would you even start? Or if you were making a plan, what would be your first thing? You know, do you get a notebook? Do you start, you know, writing things down? Do you write down emergency numbers? Do you, you know, make sure you have a backup source for your cell phone? I mean, you know, if you have a 12-year-old like I do, and he does not have access to something to entertain him technologically, he's going to flip out on me. So, you know, and plus, you know, I need my cell phone for emergency purposes too, but if you can keep them calm, then you can work. So we want to stay safe. So right off the bat, this is how we stay safe. These are three pamphlets that I have downsized that we have in our office that are quick numbers, quick facts. If you need quick answers, this is where you can get them. Virginia 211 is a big, big thing that we encourage. So here are different kinds. It looks like there's eight different kinds of incidents that I've accumulated today. So we'll get started. So the first thing we tackle when we're talking about different circumstances is know the rules. Make them short and sweet. All my life I've heard stop, drill, and roll. Stop, drop, and roll. Don't run. You know, it's going to make all that burning combustible stuff, it's going to make it worse. So, you know something short and sweet that you can remember, because during that time your adrenaline's pumping and your mind is racing, so you have to keep it simple. Fire safety. Okay. Know what your breaker box will hold. Don't overload your outlets. Don't run wires under rugs. You know, Christmas lights are a big thing. Don't have cloth materials in front of your outlets. Check your wiring, make sure it's up to date. I live in a 100-year-old farmhouse, so you know, part of that wiring is extremely old and we can't overload it. Now we've upgraded a lot of it, but there's still always potential for fire hazard. Then again, there are forest fires and there are fires on my farm and there are all kinds of fires. So know what your hazards are when it comes to a fire. Think of, you know, and get your families involved. brainstorm with them. If you get them actively involved in, hey, what is an emergency? Well, how are we going to handle that emergency? They'll be more likely to remember it if they take hand in helping you prepare for it. So we're going to move on to floods. Okay, this is a big thing. A lot of people don't understand the difference between a warning, a flash flood, and a flash flood warning. So, you know, they think flood warning or flash flood. Well, okay, flood warning is, okay, it's coming. It's raining pretty steady. It's going to raise pretty steady. You have time to evacuate. You need to do that. You have a little more time. If it's a flash flood, it's going to come very quickly in a matter of minutes, less than an hour, and you have to step your game up a little bit, I guess, is what I would say. So, the cause to nearly half of the flash flood-related deaths are people try to drive through it. That's terrible. You don't know. Lots of times, I know last year I was working a flood this past February, and I was in Coburn, and I have traveled this road 100 times over. And when I went to check Tom's Creek, which is what it's called, I didn't realize there was a dip in the road. You would never, so small that you wouldn't even realize it, except when that water was running and I saw the truck go through that water in front of me, then I realized there was a dip in the road, and that road is not near as flat as I thought it was. Then he had trouble. And so just because the ground appears to be flat doesn't necessarily mean it's going to, especially in this region. So don't drive through standing water. The undercurrent is extremely dangerous. Landslides. I added this one, Phil, because I've worked several slides here in Wise County in the last 3 years because of the excessive rain. There are two different kinds of slides. One is unusually they are slow moving. We live in the mountains, and so you have all this underground water, and it appears to just come out in the streams, but it's not going to. It has to go somewhere. When that rain starts coming down and it builds up in those mountains, it's going to come out wherever it can, wherever the least resistance is. Now, sometimes that will happen quickly, and sometimes that will not happen. Sometimes it will happen very slowly. But if it's slow, if you're looking around and you see a gap or an edge in the ground and it's been raining a lot, chances are you've got some kind of underground stream under there. So here at the bottom, there are 4 places where are typical where they have slides. Then you run into a fast slide where it's a very steep slope off of a mountain. Maybe they've been clear cutting and they don't have enough trees to hold that ground anymore, or maybe a big rock and they've been mining, or maybe they're mining underneath it, or what, all kinds of circumstances. But either way it goes, landslide still is a result, I guess, of weather preparedness, because they're deadly. If you have a big rock fall on you, or a bunch of dirt, or if you're in the mountains and it's snowing, you know, it's kind of like an avalanche. So safety for landslides, like I said a while ago, is look for patterns. Look for where your water puddles. Look for your steep grounds. Look where your water runoff is. Look where your dirt maybe has eroded a little bit. So if you keep an eye on your ground, on your land around you, you will be able to predetermine usually where those slides could potentially be. And if you do have a slide, you need to contact the county or the EOC or the whoever's in charge of that in your area to get mitigation measures put into place to take care of it. Thunderstorms. So there's, again, like the flooding, there's a watch and a warning. A watch is like, okay, this is going to occur. a warning is, hey, this is about to happen. Take shelter. Safety. Well, you don't want to be on the water. And if it's, you know, lightning, you want to make sure you're somewhere where it's grounded. You want to be in a home or you know, you don't want to park under a bridge or something of that nature. You don't want to be around any kind of power lines. I think we're all pretty understanding of what that means to live through a thunderstorm. So a winter storm. Well, we've not had a whole lot of winter storms around here lately, but I expect we'll probably do one pretty soon. These warnings are very much the same. You're expecting snow, or you're expecting heavy snow with high winds, or you're expecting freezing temperatures. And all of those require basically the same kind of preparedness. They will tweak, I guess, just a little bit. If you have a blizzard, generally you can expect on losing electricity. So your preparation may be a little bit more in depth. A big thing with winter storms is if you're outside and you do have a freeze warning, you want to make sure you have several layers. You want to make sure that all of your lower and or your outer extremities have a way to be covered and don't risk frostbite. Earthquakes. Now, I don't think we're going to have any earthquakes in this area, but we did seem to have one a couple of hours away. I think that was maybe 3 or 4 weeks ago, which is the closest one that I have ever heard of. But earthquakes, obviously they occur without us knowing. They're instant. I mean, they just happen and there's no warning. And everybody knows what an earthquake is. You know, the ground is rumbling underneath. It shifts or it moves or it's whatever. But the risks of those are always life-threatening. You don't know how there's no way to determine how severe that is going to be. Well, not in this area. They don't determine that. So maybe they probably do in an area that has them a little more often, but they move your buildings. They rattle your structure foundations. They can cause your dams to fail, your levees to fail. They can cause landslides, avalanches. The after effect of an earthquake is what is probably more dangerous than the earthquake itself. So if you live in an area or you're traveling to an area where there's a potential earthquake, then you kind of need to know what the prepared series or the prepared protocol is for that area. You need to contact the localities to find out where the safe spots are and find out what their evacuation plan is or what their situations are, where you would go, where you would meet, who you would contact, things of that nature. Hurricane. I don't think we'll have a hurricane either, but we sure do have a lot of after effects of hurricanes up through here. So their peak season is June to November. Well, their regular season is June to November, and their peak season is August and September. So we all know what a hurricane is, and we all know what it damages and destroys. And it's a whole lot like tornadoes and earthquakes. They're deadly. So they can have a lot of after effects that trigger road damage, structure damage, utility damage. If you have sewer line damage, then you have unsafe drinking water conditions. The biggest thing to remember in all of these disaster type instances is that 911 lines are on overload and your first responders are totally overwhelmed. So if you have a plan in place, that helps them that much more. So if you know what the rules are and you are prepared for them and you're not in a panic and you are staying calm, then you're not burning up the 911 calls so that the people that are truly hurt can get through to the first responders. So this is a small outline of what to do before, during, and after a hurricane, which I kind of already went over. You know the risk, you know the evacuation routes, gather your supplies, decide if you're gonna stay or go. If you're gonna stay, you need to do whatever you need to do to your property. If you're gonna stay, if you're gonna leave, then you might do something different. If you decide to stay, stay inside. Find the safe spot in your house, wherever that may be, where the structure is sound. You want to stay away from the water. You want to stay away from the windows and the doors. Be aware of the eye of the hurricane. You'll think it's over. It's not over. You will have a secondary set of flooding and winds and damage. Afterwards, people want to know. They want to know what it looks like. They have to get out. They have to go look. Don't do that. First of all, your emergency operations is trying to take care of them, the situation. If you're there, they can't watch you and take care of the people that are hurt. So you need to stay clear, steer clear, even though you want to see it. You need to steer clear of it and make sure that they have the chance and the room and the time and the space that they need to take care of the emergency. I'm sure you'll get to see enough of all of that later, but if you don't, it's still better that you're better safe than sorry and you don't put yourself in danger. Tornado, it's kind of like a hurricane. So it's kind of like a hurricane on dry ground. So a hurricane is like a tornado over the water. Okay, so it has a lot of the same similarities, except you don't have water and coastal debris, you have internal land debris of trees and buildings and objects flying. And so, you know, if you live in a mobile home, it can turn it over. If you're in a car, you know, the biggest thing they say is don't park under a bridge or a bypass. 200 miles an hour is pretty strong winds. I hope I don't ever have to live through that. So again, I did this much the same way. It's very similar. So, you know, if you're in a location where they have tornadoes, find out what their protocol is. Identify the shelters. Find out what their warning system is and where you would tune in, like EAS and NOAA. You know, it's always handy to have one of those winding radios that you can catch the weather and any kind of emergency report, whether you have electricity or not. Tornadoes are like hurricanes. You want to stay away from all the windows and doors. You want to make sure you have as much shielding, mattresses and blankets and things of that nature as you can to protect yourself. You want to be in a good area where it's a load-bearing wall and you have plenty of support above you. A lot of people talk about turning couches over on themselves or getting in a bathtub, anywhere you think is structurally sound enough. And you may not have that. If you don't have that in your home, then, or you don't have that where you're staying, you might want to find out where is the closest place to go. After it's over, always turn off all of your utilities. Gas leaks are a big thing. So you might have some explosions or you might have a downed power line. That's always dangerous. Don't go into damaged buildings or damaged structures, damaged areas. You don't know what's under all of that debris. And again, I always try to reserve the phone lines for emergencies. Oh, I can't see this, Phil. Hold on, let me see if I can move my. So if you're creating a plan, like I've said before, you sit down with your family, talk about what kind of emergencies that may be around you that you may potentially face. Get their ideas and then come up with a plan. If you have husband, wife, older kids, elderly, find a meeting spot, have a telephone, like a prayer chain, have a, like, you know, you're connecting a chain of communication where, you know, so-and-so is going to get in touch with this one, and then this one, and then this one. Make copies of your plan, hand it out, make sure everybody is clear on everything. So if in that plan, as small of the, as those details may be, if you're hurt and you are not able to communicate, somebody needs to know who your primary care physician is, what your health conditions are, what kind of medications you take, where you want to be taken to the hospital, you know, MedFlight. And I'm not, I don't think it's MedFlight. I can't remember the name exactly of it. I wish I could. And I'm sure some of you do know already, but you, there's an insurance for $60 a year where they'll come and get you no matter where you're at. And, you know, if you had to be med flighted out, you're looking at $25,000-$35,000 for one flight. This insurance is $60 a year and it pays for it. Talk with your extended family. Maybe you're responsible for some of them, your neighbors. Make an emergency kit. And I brought my CERT kit tonight to go over a few of the things that I keep. I have one of these in my car and I have one of these in my house. This goes along with the communication plan I just talked about. You know, on my refrigerator, I have a list of all the important telephone numbers that my mom or my son might need. Down here are some of the sites that I mentioned earlier that can help you with your ideas and maybe some things you hadn't thought about. And there are as many things out there to think about as there are people. So I'm always for as much information as I can get, because it's probably something likely that I haven't even thought of and that you may need to actually consider. These are just a couple more resources of what's available out there. This is the kit I brought tonight to show you. So when you're making your kit, let your kids get involved. Like my son has a kit in our car and he has a kit in the house. You know, anything that he thinks might be important. If they are involved, they'll be more likely to remember the plan. So now we're talking about staying calm. These are some strategies to help you stay calm, because if you get rattled, then you're going to lose your train of thought. And it's really not going to help anybody. So take some deep breaths. If you practice yoga, I don't, but if you do, think back about when maybe you had a fun time or, you know, you were laughing and you were playing, and it kind of takes the scaredness away. Play cards. If you write, if you read, make sure you get plenty of rest. You cannot be calm if you're tired. Move, get lots of exercise. It will work out the anxiety as well. So I'm sharing a few pictures from the winter storm in 2015 here in Wise. And if I were in person, I would ask, what did you do to prepare? Did you have any damage? Did you suffer any injuries? Were you prepared? How did it affect your area? What could you have done? If you're looking back, what would you do differently? So I'm going to show you a few pictures. This is Coburn on the 4-lane. This is a farm in the eastern part of the county. That's a barn. That was the food bank here in Norton. And that's it. Does anybody have any questions? That went quicker than I thought it would. Oh, I almost forgot. Let me show you my pack. Let me turn you around here. Okay, see if I can do this. I don't know that I'm good at it. Okay, so this item, it's glow in the dark. You break them and they're like lanterns. And then I have a notepad and I have a marker and I have a whistle. Some sanitary cloths. I have a rain poncho. I have bandage care, where you have larger bandages, and then I have ace bandages and gauze and a splint. This is an antiseptic with gloves package. Of course, you know, we're all using masks these days. This is a hazmat pack. This also is a hazmat pack with a jumpsuit. I have a first aid kit with lots of different kinds of batteries and antiseptic and bee stings. I have a rope because I have a blanket that can be a tent or it can be a blanket. Zip ties. Universal gloves, a multi-tool that can either break a car window or turn off a gas meter or a water meter. I have some duct tape. I have a flashlight in here. I have a crowbar. I have some safety goggles. And I have a water container. And I keep it in this bag. You see this bag?
Did you take my ring?
Your what?
Where's my ring? That ain't funny.
I have not touched your ring.
Okay. Now I'm really done.
All right. Thank you very much, Summer. Any questions?
Good stuff, Summer. Good stuff. Awesome. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Yeah, very good job.
Good stuff. Yeah, I think it's, you know, inherent we need to be weather aware. You know, things like weather radios are great. That sort of thing. I know last night it was mentioned, I know Woody had mentioned he had taken the weather spotter class virtually. The Jackson office offered that virtually back in the spring. I'm not sure if the Morristown office, which covers Virginia, the portion of Virginia of Wise and Norton's in, I'm not sure if they offered that virtually or not, but I know Jackson offered it virtually. If I recommend, if you all can get that, if you've never been through the that course, it takes about 2 hours, but it's great. Great information, definitely. And then what they do is they get your name and number, and if there is something that they see on radar that comes through your area, they'll literally pick the phone up and call you. I've been called before. Then if you see, you know, penny size hail or pea size hail or whatever, you can pick the phone up and call the 800 number and report it that, hey, I had this at 6:37 on Thursday, September the 3rd. And that gives them an idea. So that's a really good course.
Yes. Jessica provides, she coordinates, my supervisor, which is the coordinator for the EOC, coordinates with Morristown once a year. And they come here. I've had it twice myself. They come here and offer it for county employees, and then they try to do a residential for like a citizens type class as well. So they do, it is offered in Wise County.
Okay. Now you had mentioned earlier that you're currently teaching a cert or?
I was until COVID-19 came along. I was teaching a cert, yes. And the county has tried to create a cert team in the county, and we were in the beginning stages of that last fall, and it had to be postponed. So this is my cert bag that I carry. So, and it's about a, I think it's about a 2 or 3 day course. It goes into, that's where I pulled a lot of this information I gave you today and a lot of these resources is from that cert packet.
I had noticed that. I'm actually cert trained and I've taught cert. And so, yeah, it's a 40 hour class, but it's really good. It's really intense. And I know there, David's had issues over here with, you know, getting a number of people involved with cert, and you gotta be dedicated with it. And so, but you know, I'll recommend that as well. If to this group, if cert comes available, that's something good, you know, because the thing is with cert, Summer will tell you, is to take care of yourself and then take care of the people in your neighborhood, the people on your street, and then venture out from there. But your number one concern is you and your family, and then go from there. But you may be called on by Summer or whoever's in your county to participate in something that's normally not major. But and then I know, you know, there's some off-season things that, you know, you may be called into to hand out pamphlets, stuff like that, for to do things like this right here. So cert's really good, but the weather spotter class is good too. So who knows, they may be offering more of those virtually. You never know.
Summer, one thing I'll mention, and something I think you and Jessica do a really good job on, is lots of times it comes down to reporting the damage during some of these weather events. And I know that when it comes to agricultural damage, whether it's lost livestock or lost farm structures, usually when they call you all, you all let Extension know, and then Extension normally passes that on to the USDA, and they're maybe some programs. So it's important to report that if you've lost livestock or you have any damage to your farm whatsoever, because that can play a role in getting programs in here later that will help reimburse farmers for those types of damages. So but again, I know you and Jessica always are good to get us updates on any kind of agricultural related damage that might come about.
Well, we kind of feel like we're all in this together. And so we want to make sure that all parties that need to be part of the team are part of the team.
Good stuff. Yeah. And it, you know, it takes a team. I know the flooding that we had in February, I walked into the command center basically at the courthouse, and it was crazy. Phones ringing off the hook. And everybody had a phone in each ear, and you know, it was a pretty impressive to watch something behind the scenes develop. And I mean, in a matter of minutes, we had people that were, because of the flooding, we had people that were landlocked, I guess you could say, mm-hmm. in their houses. And you know, you're having to get a rescue team in there, and it was eye opening, definitely.
Well, I want to add that that's the reason we wanted to have a cert team in Wise County, is because lots of times we're busy taking the calls or trying to make sure we get the first responders to the people like that. So we need a secondary group of people that can go and do some of these other jobs, and I don't want to say smaller jobs, because they're all important. All of those jobs are important when lives are at stake, and you just don't know how quickly somebody can be in, you know, life-threatening danger. So, you know, if we had a group of volunteers, you know, that was out maybe riding around checking things out, and hey, the water's rising here now, and well, you know, there's only about a dozen of us, and we can't be everywhere all at the same time. you know, and if you have deputies evacuating this side of the county and you know, you have somebody else evacuating this, you can't cover 40,000 square miles. You can't 400 square miles. You can't do that. So, you know, if we had, you know, it's kind of like the Ranger, the explorers, the youth that we have in the police force, they're a big help. So, you know, sometimes maybe they just couldn't go get their medicine that day because they couldn't get out, or, you know, they need somebody to run to the store and get them some milk because it's an elderly woman and she's afraid to drive in that. So, I mean, there's a lot of things, a lot of needs that maybe aren't life-threatening, but they're still, nevertheless, they're a need.
Definitely, definitely. And even, you know, even things like, you know, we ran into an issue that I got a call about back during that flood in February. Hey, can you run to the road garage and grab some barricades and put them up across the so-and-such bridge? You know, it's things like that. And so The command center can literally call somebody and say, we need you to do this. Can you take some caution tape? Can you go up there and sit in your vehicle until we can get something to you?
Right.
You know, and that's not that, you know, it sounds simple, but it's not, it's needed. So having the volunteers for that, that's big.
All right. Well, again, Summer, thank you very much. And I guess Jeremy David is going to be back Tuesday. Is that right? Doing basic first aid.
David will be here, but I think actually who we have, we've got an EMT from Lifeguard Ambulance Service that will be here with us.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay. Good deal.
The good stuff, son. Right. Awesome.
Well, yes, thank you.
We're all throws a big thumbs
up. So we'll close it. Hope everybody has a good evening.
Thanks, Phil.
Good night,
y'all.
Thank you.
See you Tuesday.